let's get started. And then if, as and when Ben decides to join us, he can introduce himself properly. But for those of you that have not been to a power clinic before, my name is Hector Minto. I'm the Director of E-Commerce here at Tobii Dynavox. And we try to run these power clinics every 2 weeks, so you can openly ask questions on a subject that we pitch online through social media and through our forums a few weeks before. And tonight, we're talking about AAC and music, and access to music software and the potential impact that music has on somebody learning to use AAC, or even learning to use their access method. We'll hopefully cover both. We'll be here for about an hour. Tonight, I'm really happy to be joined by actually more than the people on this slide here, but I'm joined by Emily. Emily, perhaps you can introduce yourself.
Yeah, okay. So my name's Emily, as you can see on the slide, and I'm a speech and language therapist. And yeah, I'm looking forward to tonight's webinar, talking about music, and I've been looking a little bit about how that affects language development. And yeah, excited to hear what Ben's got to say as well.
I should say Emily is our speech and language therapist.
Just a random one you picked up.
So Emily has recently joined in the UK, based in the UK. She's going to be running events over here on a whole host of topics. I kind of feel a bit sorry for her sometimes because she's going to have to be somewhat of an expert in everything from ALS, MND, to aphasia, to Rett syndrome, to any number of AAC or assistive technology users, and still be a speech and language therapist. So that's a heck of a challenge.
Yeah, quite a lot.
Yeah, go.
Yeah, no, it is quite a big challenge, but, you know, one that we're taking on just one step at a time.
And we're going to be joined by Ben Schogler from Skoog Music. He's not here to be embarrassed, but Ben is pretty cool. He started his own company a few years back, developing a musical instrument specifically for special needs, but from the outset made sure that it was the sort of special needs instrument that anybody would want to play with. So even people like me, as I'll explain in a moment, who know absolutely nothing about music, still manage to interact in some kind of meaningful way when they use a Skoog. We've been working with him for a few years now, developing an eye gaze equivalent to the hardware system. Yeah, he's going to talk to us about that, but he's not going to just talk to us just about the product. He's going to be my authority on music because I know absolutely nothing, which I'll explain in a moment. Also online, I've got Bob Geenan. Bob, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. I'm the product manager for the BoardMaker and PCS product line, and I was just hoping to catch some of the webinar, but I'd be happy to contribute as well.
We're going to get Bob to show how what's available for chatting about music on BoardMaker later on, and also I want to show you a pretty cool feature in BoardMaker Online that allows you to very quickly create lyrics sheets for AAC. Called Symbolate, which some of you may be familiar with from previous versions of BoardMaker. We also have David Hendrick, who's been on a power clinic before.
Yeah, exactly. Am I still being heard here? Yes. Hi.
Yeah.
I'm the product manager for most things to do with eye tracking in Tobii Dynavox, so the PCIs and the Explorers and the Minis and the iMobiles and things like that, and the software that goes along with it, including Windows Control and the GazePoint software and that kind of thing. I happen to have a background in music, surprisingly enough, so this will be interesting.
It's going to be great. I actually think this is going to be the first power clinic online where I don't talk a lot. This is going
to
be good.
I'm also jumping in to listen in, but I'll be happy to contribute as well.
Great. Okay, for those of you that are here for the first time, power clinics are informal. Honestly, there are no stupid questions. There's a chat window on the right-hand side there. We have mums and dads, we have speech and language therapists online, I think we've got some music therapists here tonight, but basically people with a whole host of different experiences, and when we start talking about, say, maybe the eye gaze technology, or we suddenly start talking about AAC strategies, there's always somebody who's sitting there thinking, I don't know what they're talking about. So we check the question box regularly, and we respond to your questions, so keep asking questions as we talk. Just type away in that box. This is the AAC and Music Clinic. We want to do these every 2 weeks and have kind of stuck to that. But obviously the number of topics that we have, you know, there's a huge number of topics. We really need to hear from you what you'd like us to talk about. We're lining one up for aphasia very shortly. That's probably the next one that we do. Oh, that's Ben ringing me. When I say at the top here that these are informal, we're also going to be jumping to Ben's screen or jumping to my screen when he gets here. We'll be jumping into different pieces of software. Just give us time to do that and take the opportunity to post your comments and questions there. Just to quickly recap, my disclaimer on this webinar before I get started and start talking is that I know absolutely nothing about music. When I was 7 years old, I made so much noise with my recorder that they basically banned me from recorder class. And I was pretty good at maths, so they sent me to do extra maths. In the 1980s, that's probably a common experience. I didn't have the best music teacher. They basically got rid of me from the start. So I'm probably going to be asking a lot of those kind of crazy questions that that some of you are maybe thinking as well as we go through the webinar. Okay. I'd like to hand this bit over to Emily, because what we're going to basically be talking about from the start is the importance of playing with sound. And so when children are kind of normally developing, how important is music and sound and playing with sound in the development of speech? So, Emily, over to you.
Yeah, so I suppose the bit to start with is really to talk about if we boil language and speech down to its bare bones, really all it is just playing with sounds, because language is just units of, well, sounds, which are units of meaning strung together to create something that you and I can understand from each other. So when I was thinking about this webinar, I actually looked at the definition of music, which it said was, I think I've written it down somewhere, creative play with sounds, which really is all language is. Babies, they will babble, which is then playing with sounds to then obviously string them together into words and sentences, into what you and I use today to communicate with each other. So there's lots of different things that are important with speech development. I think you've got a few of them written there. So turn-taking, obviously massively important, as that's what a conversation is. Intentional sound. So, Hector, I'm assuming from that, do you mean, obviously, babies babble and we assume intentionality, therefore teaching it?
Yeah, and one of the things that we are always talking about in the world of AAC is the bits that kids with physical disabilities or sensory difficulties or learning difficulties, we're talking about the bits that they miss. And so when we have a child with a condition in a wheelchair and they make a sound, do people assume the same levels of intention as a normally developing child? That's an interesting discussion to have. In previous webinars we've also talked about vision, and so when somebody has given a diagnosis of CVI, and you know, parents will read that, and then we start thinking about somebody's visual ability. And if we start assuming that things that they're not seeing things in the same way that we might assume that somebody's not making sound intentionally, do we respond differently? And I think it's fair to say we do. As a world, we probably respond differently. Mm-hmm. One of the things Ben was wanting to talk about in this slide is that it's so important that we improvise with experts, with these bare bones. So when we think about all the things that we use, a speech language therapist role is to listen to sounds of babies developing, if we're trying to get somebody's speech going, listen to those sounds and help children work with those sounds to develop speech. Yeah, exactly.
I think the intentionality is really an interesting point. I think when babies and young children are making sounds and making noises, we do place a meaning on that, and we model it back to them. And so, yeah, we teach that intentionality, and that's what we're doing as the experts, I suppose, not just as speech and language therapists, but actually if we think of all of us as experts in communication, because we all do it every day. So we use that expert role.
So if we think of a child who now is unable to make those sounds or develop those sounds or form those sounds physically, mm-hmm. We're talking about areas of their development that they miss out on. Yeah? And so music and maybe AAC and making music through other means is a way for us to replace some of that development. Because one of the things that Ben and I were talking about earlier is if even if you're processing those sounds internally, that's also a part of an important part of your brain development.
Yeah, I mean, the internal voice is certainly a really interesting aspect of language development, especially those high-level language skills. Yeah.
Okay. We'll keep going until Ben joins us. Okay, so what...
Just so you know what I said.
Have you contacted...
I sent you an access code, Hector. Did you see that? I don't have his contact directly, but I sent...
Okay, give me a minute, everyone. Sorry, let's try and get Ben online.
He looks like he's coming in right now.
Oh, really?
Hello.
Wow.
He's here.
Hello, everyone. I'm incredibly sorry. Scotland has had chronic internet failure. I'm in the street on my 4G, desperately trying to contribute something that I care really passionately about. I can't get in.
I'm not going to make a comment about Scotland, and I'm just not.
Because they'll cut the line. They'll cut the hard line.
Cut the line,
and then we'll be done. Okay.
Okay. Let's not. Ben, let me give you the opportunity to introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Ben Schogler. I'm a developmental psychologist who has moved over into technology and education. Was part of a lot of work going on across various universities looking at how to facilitate communication and particularly music making for kids unable to do more traditional things. And as a result, I got involved in creating new technologies and have since left, well, not left academia, but we've started a company where we create a music interface for young people. And it's called Skoog, and we engage in a variety of different things, working with iGaze, working with Skoog, but essentially we're all about trying to make it easier for people, children, adults, whoever it is, to make music and enjoy it, essentially, without the having to go down any traditional route.
Okay, and I'm assuming you can't see our screen now, Ben.
I can see your screen. I'm actually online, and I'm trying to resurrect the various other things that I was going to show you, but I'm here to contribute now, so I don't need playing the sound. That's my thing. That's what I love.
So talk to us about playing with sound. Why is playing with sound important?
It's so crucial. It's so fundamental. Because when you think about it's really odd. So the way that we came through this, when I joined psychology years and years ago, there were people using music as a metaphor for talking about describing communication, and we came in and said, it's not a metaphor. What kids are doing, what mothers are doing, what parents are doing is music. And essentially, the way that we learn language, and this is I'm borrowing from Victor Wooten, who's a very famous bass player, is that we allow children to improvise with us as experts, as expert vocal talking musician-y type people. We can control our voices, we can do these symbols, we know the code for talking, and we allow kids to play with that. So a child will interrupt two adult speaking and they'll go, ah, and they'll go, ah, 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 and there's this whole thing around that, and play and support them. And it's that playing with sound and being given the freedom to play with sound that actually promotes communication, that develops this whole thing called language, which is layered on top of it, which is not the end goal, but that ability to share sound with other people, that's what musicians build their musical skills on, but it's also what underpins our communication. And it's not focused, it doesn't have to be sound. It's about sharing time with other human beings and being recognized in space. The great thing about sound is that it takes you and puts you in a space. So people can interact with you without touching, that you're physically there because these sound waves are there. But it can be touch, it can be sight, it can be, it can be all these things, but it's about sharing time with people, and that's why playing is so important, and the freedom to play with it and giving people and particularly young people, the freedom to make sounds, to make mistakes, to interrupt, to change, change the subject, as it were, sonically. And that's where music can play such a massive role.
Perfect. Good. Let's set the scene for where we are in most schools around the world today, the most special ed schools. Pre-Skoog, let's say. Let's call it pre-Skoog.
Okay.
But I remember, I mean, I've been working in this field for almost 20 years, and for years, the absolute stock equipment in a special ed classroom is the PowerLink, which is a great product. And the PowerLink basically allowed people who use a switch to be able to turn music on and off. And so we got so much cause and effect work going where we had a tape player set to play, and then somebody would plug a switch in, the PowerLink would be the tape player would be plugged into the PowerLink, and then people would press the switch and music would play. They'd press the switch, it would stop. Or they would press the switch, it would play for 10 seconds, it would turn itself off, and that would encourage somebody to press the switch again. So it was a great way to get kids motivated to hit their switches.
It's actually being used now in stroke patients.
I'm sure.
To rehabilitate movements, so that having to turn the switch back on again is forcing them to move and use the handle and stuff, but we can do better.
Yeah, because fundamentally this is kind of a binary selection. It's like music on or music off. And I'm certainly not here to say that's not a great piece of equipment. That's absolutely a great piece of equipment, but it's based on switches. Soundbeam is also something that's been around for years. And again, I mean, how many soundbeams are there out there, Ben?
A few thousand.
Yeah, certainly. And the whole idea there was you had a soundbeam that you could break. And you would move your hand up and down and affect the sound, the MIDI, is that right, Ben?
Yep.
The MIDI that was playing, the sounds that were being played. And they made it switch accessible so that you could still, somebody who couldn't physically move their hand in between those beams up and down would have the binary on-off of the different MIDI notes. Yeah?
Okay. It is incredibly accessible. It's... all you have to do is break the beam, but then that has... There are other things about knowing you've broken the beam, where is the beam, how do I get into the beam, there's other things, but as a switching device that's linked to music, the effort required is so minimal that it is, you know, it's incredible. You know, you just have to break a beam of invisible light and you can do something. So on that front, it is a real amazing thing.
Okay. Cool. Let's carry on. Okay. So, but I often joked with people in schools when they were playing tapes, and this was probably in the early noughties, let's say that. But I would walk into special ed establishments, and I would hear kids listening to ABBA, and I would be like, why are they listening to ABBA? I mean, who listens to ABBA anymore?
Hey. Nothing wrong with ABBA, sir.
Emily, do you have anything on this? Emily loves musical theatre, yeah?
Yeah, love it.
Yeah, okay. Anyway, I took the view at the time that it was kind of a bit unfortunate that when all the other kids were listening to, let's say, One Direction, they were listening to New Kids on the Block tapes, because fundamentally the technology that the kids had access to in the schools was based around tape players, because these were the only devices that you could leave permanently on and access from the power link.
But so that is a really important point, though, in terms of
what's cultural, and I would love to spend a couple of minutes talking about what is cultural. Yeah,
I mean,
please.
Well, there's one really important thing which goes back in terms of the speech therapy, in terms of how we learn language, and in terms of being with our parents and our caregivers and people around us. And that means that whatever we're in, it's all the content that we learn in, say, learning language in a traditional sense through interacting with parents with voice and play, is all culturally just tailored beautifully to you and your surroundings. It is you and your surroundings. And so there's no finer cultural support than that. And then, so to, you know, in the context of AAC, or when we're trying to facilitate the people to, you know, in terms of developing communication later on or by different means, to be anything else is kind of substantial. So anything that can be brought closer to a cultural norm with an individual or be relevant to them, it's going to be so much more beneficial and so much more powerful, even just turning it on and off. If it's the right tune, turning it on and off, that can have a massive impact.
Exactly, and you would want the kind of them to be hearing in school the kind of music that their brothers and sisters were listening to at home. I mean, that's the point. So that they then have something to bond over and have something to communicate about. So, we should maybe try and move away from switches and switch, and not move away from switches, but move away from tape players. Like, let's move away from tape. Although, I'm probably going to find out that tape is coming back in some kind of retro, comeback.
Tape's not coming back.
Is tape not coming back? Okay, good. I'm glad. Don't worry about it. Because I miss those pencils, you know. All right. Okay. Good. Right. Let's carry on. Let's just have a quick shout out to Inclusive Technology because they faced the same problems we all faced. And so a few years back, they came out with a Switch-accessible MP3 player. That was discontinued, and now they're using what's called the Little Listener, which allows you to import MP3 and make it Switch accessible. So that's at least the special ed world has moved across to MP3. That's an important point. Of course, we now have all sorts of apps on iPads and things that allow us to switch between playlists and move up and down on playlists. So we're using mainstream apps to do a lot of this stuff as well. So we're certainly not here to say that making a song start and making a song stop is not important. It absolutely is. Please,
can I jump in a little bit?
Yep.
So it isn't. So if you think about, I mean, this has a big impact in terms of thinking about DJing and stuff. But if you go right back to the start of DJing, which is the selectors in Jamaica, in terms of just choosing tunes and putting them on, you're really starting to deliver. You know, what you're doing by kind of being able to kind of structure a set of tunes, put them together, start them when you want, stop when you want, is you're being a kind of, you know, you're being a conductor in a way. And what a traditional selector or a kind of old-fashioned DJ does, you know, is building a playlist in relation to the mood of an audience and respond to that. So it has, and no one would question the musical integrity of a conductor, or even a theatre director putting on saying we're going to play these songs then, you know. And so even just that ability to choose between tracks and choose what comes next, what comes before, even the volume, and maybe even, I know that the switches don't do it, but there are many apps that allow you to kind of blend things a bit and start to think about how they come together. That's already giving you a bit more interaction, and it's that interactivity that we want. You know, I know you're going to talk about it in a bit, but that ability to do something a bit more and to take it a bit further and make your music interactive, that's what's so important.
And in our communicator software, we have the ability to create playlists so that people can create their own playlists, but nobody has ever made a big deal of it in a way. It's been much more about just making a single song start and finish. So yeah, for the ability to actually change your playlist on a daily basis is something maybe we should all revisit within the communication software.
I think so, but I think on top of that, it's for another webinar at a different time. But the some people look down on DJs, or some people look down on that. You know, is it a musical skill? Are we really talking about something? And you know, really, it is particularly when it's done right, and the ability to put together and string tunes together and make playlists and sculpt a mood in that way is really quite a unique and creative and beautiful thing.
Okay, so let's now talk about kids who can access instruments directly, because obviously there's a huge benefit. The minute that you can actually physically take direct control of something rather than using a switch to have indirect access, certain things open up. I'll let you run with this, Ben.
Yeah, no, I mean, it is that tangible, physical thing. I mean, I think what's really important to know, particularly with the slide that's on at the moment, is all of those instruments that are on the screen right now, they are technology. And we need to stop thinking, and we need to kind of get rid of this kind of technology thought digital barrier where it's like, oh, but it's an electronic instrument, it makes it more digital, and it's technology. A drum is technology, a cymbal is technology, a string is technology. And so this is already kids accessing technology to create or control sound. The beautiful thing about acoustic instruments like these that you see is that when you touch them, they make a sound, and it's very direct. And this idea of, you know, being in direct, you know, when you touch it, it makes a sound. When you stop touching it, the sound is changed or stops in some way. So you're physically in touch with the sound. And that's sometimes where electronic things can change, but we can talk about it later. But it's that ability to affect, you know, the control of its agency in the world. You know, you're hearing what you're doing. You can see, people can see what you're doing. And that ability to control something outside yourself as well. You know, again, great for perception and sensory integration, that idea of coordinating what you're doing in the world. But I think, you know, at the bottom of this list of, you know, having those different physical things, being able to, you know, differentiate yourself from others through different things, the way they look, the way they sound, but going right back down to, you know, the human voice is an instrument, and it's an incredibly powerful instrument, and it's one we all take for granted so much. You know, it's amazing that for many of us, you know, we start off and we, as soon as we're born, we have control of this polyphonous, harmony-generating, incredible device that allows us to captivate other people in our surroundings. And it's, you know, imitation has been demonstrated and proved for about 10 years now since birth, even with premature babies. So, you know, it's something, our ability to use our voices in this way, to make sounds, and to impact on the environment wider than ourselves and invite people in to join us. It's this thing about sharing time with human beings and having instruments like these. The great thing with these is that we can share the instruments with others as well. So physically we're sharing space, physically we're making sounds, and it's something we can do together. It's such a social thing. And that's the great thing about instruments, is they become a physical share, you know, in the space, and it really promotes that being with other people and making sounds with others.
Ben, can you just turn your webcam off? Somebody was saying that they can only see you and not the slides, but that's a technical issue, I think.
So if okay, you can I can turn it off. My webcam is not on now.
Okay, fine. Let's hope they can see. Okay, so the other thing, of course, that we need to kind of emphasize here is that when you're playing with a drum, you can hit a drum hard, you can hit it soft, you can hit it quickly. You can try it in different positions, you can try it on different carpets or rugs and get different sounds. These are all things that kids, when they play with musical instruments, will discover on their own without tuition. And when we looked at some of the technologies that were already in special schools, because they're so binary on-off, maybe this is a playing with sound element that a lot of children are missing. And so we're going to talk, as we move through this, about how do we replace that just playing with sound feel, okay? And that's something that I know Ben's been kind of grabbing me at exhibitions across the world for a number of years, explaining this to me, you know, that it matters how hard you blow through a flute, that makes a difference. And I just get flashbacks to my recorder lessons when I was 7, and I just switch off. But I'm starting to now to make that link between, you know, what are kids missing out on? That's really what we spend a lot of our time thinking about now at Tobii Dynavox.
I mean, I think the to pick up on that, in that final point about the voice, is that for so many of us, we have, you know, that loud, soft, that control from so early on, that it's just such a part of our lives. So for individuals who don't have the control of their voice or other, you know, extremity, you know, body parts and things, that ability to really finely sculpt sound or interaction with others not being there, you know, to then obviously switches are great and access is great, but when, you know, we're crying, you know, people are crying out for that dynamic, the ability to sculpt, to shape. And it sounds really, really cheesy, and it is, but if you think back to that 80s video of a Lionel Richie Hello, where the blind lady sculpts his face, despite how creepy it is, Lionel Richie being in her bedroom when she doesn't know he's there and stuff, but they recently did a remake of that where they got people to close their eyes, and they blindfolded them, and they got them to try and do his face, and people could do it. This ability of people to shape forms in relation to, you know, whether it's expression or emotion and these kind of things, but to shape things. It's why we respond to art. It's why we respond to sculpture. It's why we respond to music. This, it's a dynamic, and that's what we have to kind of give people the opportunity to play with.
So we know that a lot of the kids that are AAC users are unable to play with sound for physical reasons as well as kind of other reasons, but there's still this issue of the internal voice that we were talking about earlier as well. Emily, you may have something to comment on the internal voice and why it's important.
Yeah, I mean, What exactly do you mean by the internal voice, though? You mean us speaking to ourselves in our head, etc.? And that obviously that promotes language development, and it also has that higher level language skill, which helps us think about things. And that all comes from language development itself, which I suppose music is, you know, very similar to those fundamental skills to language development. So
we were talking about humming earlier, weren't we, Ben? This idea that if a kid couldn't hum the sound back and be mimicked and make those sounds, there would still be something going on internally.
So yeah, so it's we've done various. I've had various incarnations in life in various research institutes. But so you can, even without making the sounds, if you think of the sounds, it does the same thing in terms of your neural activity, in terms of the transition, the dynamics, and the excitation is almost all there without having to hear it. It's such a pervasive dynamic that you have. So even if you go back to thinking about playing with sound, and I think this is what's so important about having a dynamic control of something. If, you know, even if you want to, you know, if you think, you know, I want to touch that and I want that sound to kind of change and sweep up, you know, you can imagine, the reason why you want it to do that is you're imagining it doing that. And the potential in your environment, the reason you're imagining it doing that is you maybe heard someone else do it, or you've seen it happen, and these kind of things. And so you begin to imagine that, and you use that acoustic imagination to kind of shape your expectation, and it starts to guide your limbs, and you know, and it can be a long way to learning how to control that particular gesture you're trying to make, but it's there, it's in your mind, and you can hear it. And that's the same, that's exactly the same for even a newborn infant. The reason they're able to imitate physical gestures and emotion and vocal gestures, which they can, is that they can see and feel and hear it in their mind's eye, as it were, and they try and then shape their behavior to copy that. And they may not be successful first time, they may try it, but it's there and it's in there, and it's that internal activity that, when I think, you know, for previously in, say, special ed or AAC situations where you may want to shape something and all you get is the ability to activate something as opposed to control it, if we can give people the opportunity to have a dynamic interaction with their surroundings, then they will begin to imagine those dynamic interactions. Right. And that internal voice, that dynamic internally, like being able to play with things in that way is as, well, not as, but can be as enriching as physically saying the words. It's that, there are two halves of the same coin. It's like the perception-action conundrum. There is no action without perception. There, you know, you need both, and you need both things to be active. And in order for you to be able to start exploring and pushing your boundaries vocally or in terms of speech or language or music, you need to have that stimulation and that opportunity in your environment. And if you don't have it, you're not going to try and push it.
So this tunes in quite nicely. See what I did there? Tunes in quite nicely.
Nice.
So this tunes in quite nicely with a lot of what's happening in the world of AAC at the moment. You know, for years, we have been making kids hit buttons, like binary buttons, like making a button and making it say a message. And now we're finally getting to realize, again, I think because of direct access methods, you know, because this is a difficult game if you're a Switch user, that playing with letters, even if it's conceived as gibberish or, you know, nonsense at the start, we want to give meaning to everything that a child spells out on a keyboard. And so a lot of AAC people now are talking about alternative pencils and the idea that we play with keyboards, and that it's incumbent upon the teacher slash therapist slash parent to give those letters meaning.
Okay. This is exactly what parents do with natural, whatever you call it, you know, when babies develop, you know,
with
that's...
With any child, we do this.
That's what we do. We call it mothering, don't we?
Or proto-conversation, it's been called, or, you know, many things, but it is the fundament, that interaction, that scaffolding, that...
But let's roll this back to the physical access. When the kids were only exposed to switches as their first, that was either on or off, so it was difficult to play with letters in any kind of repeatable way. now that we've got iPads everywhere, we've got touchscreens everywhere, we've got eye-gaze systems coming down in price and being in schools, the children are playing directly with letters.
What you're talking about, sorry, so just meaning. Yeah. I'm being flashed back to my third year psychology, which unfortunately is many years ago. It's babbling.
Yeah, of course.
So this is what you're talking about is facilitating natural babbling, which is a musical kind of scatting, as it were, in a jazz sense, that babies and young people do, playing with sound, being able to just run with the vocal gymnastics.
Yeah. So playing with the expert in this situation is maybe the teacher, the literacy coordinator, the parent, the speech and language therapist. But again, this boils down to this fact that we now realize that playing with letters is important.
It is important. I would say just a mild interjection here. Playing with the expert in some situations can actually be YouTube. I've seen a lot of really great work done just in terms of individuals managing themselves, particularly those with autism, in terms of finding stable situations or phrases or, kind of, whether it's a piece of film, whatever, and finding that stable situation and then playing within it. So although obviously much better that it's a live, living human being, it can also actually just be technology.
Yeah, yeah. So we've discovered this in AAC. I mean, it's always been there, but as I say, the technology has moved on so that more and more people can, with some of the greater physical challenges, can now play with direct access. That's really what I'm seeing. We've also seen this within the eye-gaze learning curve. When we developed the eye-gaze learning curve, one of the first things we did was make paint programs, because any child with any level of eye interaction with a screen, or touchscreen interaction with a screen for that matter, can make something appear. And when a child makes art appear, people give it meaning. People draw on a thing, they say, I can see a ghost in there, and they're making people say words.
Okay, I'm desperate to get in here.
This is the first webinar I've given where I'm struggling to get words in, so you roll on, this is great.
This art play thing, and it is such, and actually I'm going to use this later in the fields that I talk about. So here's the thing, there is no finger painting for music. We're not allowed to. In traditional primary school education, kids can paint and make do all kinds of stuff, and they bring these paintings home. Sometimes they're not that great. Sometimes they're fantastic. I have children myself, and someone's like, okay, so it's a monkey hitting a sponge. I can see that, whatever. But we allow them to play with color and form, and we think that's great. And we don't let them do it with music, with musical sounds. It's not allowed.
We know that children who paint with their eyes gain greater control of their eyes, yet feel more motivated to use their eyes, and succeed. We know this. But what we used to know was that when kids were just told to press buttons and just use AAC with eye gaze, is that there was a lot of failure to calibrate, a lot of people kind of just not getting on with the technology, until we rolled it back to what we called at the time no fail. There was no fail, because if you managed to get something up, that was success. You've just stolen the next slide. There is no finger painting in music.
I thought you'd hidden it. I thought that was my moment there, but there isn't yet.
So I think, honestly, that when I was 7 years old, this is why I failed. Because my primary school teacher went, you're not very good at this.
It's not even that long ago. So my 13-year-old... She went to a really supposed to be very good primary school in Edinburgh. And the way that they chose, so you were told you're not musical. I've heard stories of people taking a brass kind of mouthpiece and saying, blow on that, can you make a noise? Yes, right, you get to do music. No, you don't. All kinds of, and they're all kind of, they're not badly meant things. They're kind of, they only have someone who plays trumpet, so they're only going to teach people who can play trumpet. My daughter's school, they hung a cello on them, and if it touched the ground, they couldn't get to play cello because they're not big enough to carry it. And they only had a cello teacher, and that's how they decided who got to do music.
Okay.
And then this is like 5 years ago. It's not the Victorian times, and you're like, what?
So now that
can I interject?
Emily, it's your turn. Go.
Oh, is it? Oh, I'm just listening to that thinking, I mean, what you're talking about with music there, I think it's such a great analogy for what happens with a lot of our users in terms of AAC. So if you don't have immediate success with it, it's taken away from you that ability to communicate.
Yeah,
we know this. And that's partly because of funding and the barrier, you know, to
the same with music, the funding, because it needs
same
these,
with music. Yeah.
Because you need the extra things and they cost money, and actually, you know, we want to get to that point where it's not AAC, it's just communication, and everyone has the right, and whatever is needed will be given, but, you know, we're a long way off that. But, yeah, failing, and if you think, and that's the crazy thing, you think about babies, you know, it's like, a lot of people say, oh, what was your first word? And most children's first word was like, whatever, it wasn't a word, you know? But we're like, oh, that's great, you try again.
Yeah.
And I think that's something, and it's something I'm really keen to explore with you guys at Tobii. You know, we're doing various things, and we've played with some other things, but the ability to play with sound, whether it's using a music thing, and there's a whole conversation around that, which is what we're kind of talking about, but even just playing with formative sounds as part of AAC.
Can I jump in first?
Yeah,
David.
Hi, this is David. One of the most fabulous things about the modern app world, though, is saying there's no babbling in music or there's no finger painting in music. That's been the case for quite a long time. But with the advent of iPads and apps and applications on the web-based HTML applications and things like that, you've been able to bring out this type of finger painting on super cheap applications where when you touch your finger to a screen or when you look at a spot on a screen on something like Chrome Music Labs, it'll just make a wave noise, a bzzz, or something like that. So with all these cheap apps and these free test things that are coming out online, it's opening up this already now for the past few years anyway, a whole way to finger paint with music. So there's a lot of free resources that are showing up out there, as well as things like Skoog and all that are opening up this ability now.
No, it is opening up. I think I would say from my technology has kind of come very much full circle in a way. So I think one of the reasons why there's no finger painting in traditional kind of music is that the instruments, we've evolved these beautiful ways to make and control sound that require a lot of skill to learn and a system for doing it, and it's not possible to mess around with them and it be good. It just isn't. So there's a system of teaching that has this whole kind of thing going on. But those technologies have evolved, and we've managed to evolve technology now that enables us to get back to our kind of roots in a way and start, you know, making sounds more easily or making sounds in a creative way more easily. But interestingly, the kind of apps that allow you to make, you know, so like Skoog or like Bloom or like, I was looking at another one today, what was it called, Mood or something, and where the keys and tones are fitted together in a sort of way that allows you to be positive and be creative without worrying about failing. What they actually mimic, and the reason that they're positive and the reason that they work, is what they're mimicking is physical, biological, musical kind of paradigms that are based in rhythm and pentatonics, which are actually kind of biological facets of how we perceive sound, how we make sound, how our voices work. And it's kind of almost it's like technology allowing us to get back to nature, which is a fantastic thing.
So can we jump to your screen and take a look at some of this?
To my screen? Oh yeah. Well, we're risking. Well, we can try it, but we are risking. I'm on like one bar of 4G, but let's do it. Let's try it. Let's see if technology. I've just sung its praises. Let's see if it actually works for us. Okay, so I'm going to show my screen. So one thing that I suppose, let's start off with, what should we start off with? You can see my email, that's what you can start off with. So I'm going to open up, through these various chats with Hector over the years, one of the things that we developed, so Skoog itself, I don't know if you can they still see the slide or are they just seeing my screen?
Should see the screen, your screen now.
Okay, so I'm going to open up
the screen.
Just my screen. So I'm going to open up iMusic, which is a program that we developed in partnership with Tobii, actually, in terms of looking for something to create, take what we were doing with Skoog. Skoog is a tactile interface which now works with iOS and is very much about hands-on music making, and it was created specifically for kids with additional support needs, in that it's not a keyboard, it's not strings, it's a soft kind of squeezy cue. And I'm just hoping that something will start. There we go. Got something happening now. So it's a soft tactile cube, but the key thing about it is that its cubic design makes a very simple interface. And what it says is, like, let's have that users can use pencil note scales. What it does is it provides you with notes that are going to work, essentially. And I've got a kind of cool thing I'm hoping to show you if I can, with this kind of auto-tuning kind of function that we've now got with iTunes and Spotify and stuff. But let's just show you. This is iMusic. So iMusic is essentially a screen-based version of our tactile interface. Now, the tactile interface can work with those with profound physical movement problems and all kinds of things, but I just need to set this up. So you can see I've got these colored circles on the screen. There's five of them. Well, five big ones, and there's these little ones, but I'll explain that in a minute. I just need to make the sound work. So I do that once, and then hopefully turn the sound on. So it just works by dwell, and should be making a sound. Why is it not making a sound? Audio, there we go. Look at that. We're playing there. No, oh, wait. Okay, there. This is the, what caused the problem last time. Okay. Sound on. Give me some sound. Come on. Come on, technology. We're having a whole field day about you. Isn't this not? Yay! There we go. Right. Could people hear that?
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of flute sound. So what's the whole Skoog
kind of loud.
It's kind of loud, is it? I will just adjust it a little bit. What it is about saying, you know, so say with a keyboard. Turn it a bit. So, you know, with most instruments, with acoustic instruments, what you have is all the notes that you can, you know, so you need to have them all there to make the choices. But with an electronic interface, you don't need them all there all the time. Ideally, you want the ones that are going to be useful to you. And so what we did with Skoog is create this interface that did that, and this is a screen-based version of that. So if I go into, if I press the H key, now importantly for anyone watching this webinar, there's a free version of this that's available to download. It's feature limited, but it's not time limited, so that you can get it and make sounds and play and stuff. So essentially, it works by cursor control. So any head tracker, any eye gaze, and it has its own kind of dwell setting. So here, what it allows me to do, I'm playing a flute on it. So there's a different note on each of the circles. And the smaller circles are about this dynamic. So they allow me to play loud and soft. So if I move through them, I play loud and soft. If I go straight to the big ones like that, I can be loud. So it's this idea of giving people dynamic control. And also, you might notice that all of the sounds, they make me sound quite good. It sounds like I know what I'm doing. But all it's doing is we're giving you a scale that works. So we're giving you a pentatonic scale. And if you know what key a piece of music's in, which is what our kind of existing app does for Skoog, is that you can hook into iTunes and you can look up a tune and say, right, what key is that in? And then you can go and do it. And I'm not going to switch out to Skoog just now. I'm just going to stick with iMusic. I'm going to do this online very quickly just to kind of show you. So hopefully the internet will... you can all see my Facebook page, but that's no bad thing. there we go. So I'm going to go to YouTube, which is a favorite of mine. And I'm going to look up a song. And then my Skoog app is going to set on my iPad, which I'm not going to try and link it in because I think it might kill things. But I'm just going to look up a song that I like, which is called Sound and Color, right? It's by Alabama Shakes. Brilliant, brilliant tune. So I can watch this and listen to this for free on YouTube, okay? I have to just have 3 seconds of an ad. I can't even speak now. Right, so skip that. So I'm going to pause that there. So this is a really beautiful track. Now my Skoog app on my iPad, if I wanted to play Skoog with it, is telling me that's in D major. Now I don't have to know what D major is. All I have to do is be able to read. And there's websites, there's a website called E Chords, there's like apps like ours, there's other listening apps that will tell you what key a piece of music is. So if I go in now here to my iMusic and set it, here we go here. Actually, I'm going to have to choose another tune quickly. I haven't got the scale setting there because I'm on a demo version. But wait, just bear with me. What was it before? It was We Built This City on Rock and Roll. So you can see I have a wide and eclectic mix of music. So from the Muppets of recent fame. Yes, that's what I want. Right, okay. So that's in F major. I know that from looking it up earlier. So if I go to iMusic now. iMusic, there we go, come back. So now I'm in F major, so I should, if I let that play, turn it down a little bit. Let it play. For some reason that's not coming out the speakers. Why is that not coming out the speakers?
Because we're on a webinar.
Okay. Say you don't love me. I'll let you go. Say you don't care to go. Cause I don't think so. Singing in your fight. Too many runaways eating up the night. I saw you in the So despite that being super awesome, I don't know whether you can hear me still. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Despite it being super awesome, I'm able to play along with it. I don't know what I'm doing.
Could you show us the app on the iPad?
I risk ruining everything for everyone.
Okay, but basically, in the Skoog app...
I could do it if you let me put my camera on, I can do it like old-fashioned. Let's do that. So let's just put the video on. So, Skoog app is actually free as well. You don't need a Skoog to use it. Where is my webcam? So yeah, you could... I'm going to turn this on. So, can you see me?
Yeah.
Da-da-da, Skoog app, badly lit, but there you go. So I go in here into my menus, and I choose a track. It's loading. Oh, come on. But essentially, what it should do after it's loaded. No, the internet is just dead here. Yeah, we should have gone for you talking it through.
Okay, but the app shows you what key you're in.
So the app that will bring up the track. And at the bottom of the screen, it may load, it may just take a time. So the app will bring up the track, and it will tell you, it will give you a set of letters which say, it'll say D major, or F major, or G minor. And really, you don't have to know what those things are. You literally, so hopefully, can you see my screen still?
Yeah.
So in the screen kind of viewing of things, let's put it that way, you can hear, all you have to do is match that letter, and major or minor, then, and you're good to go.
And everything that somebody presses at that point will feel okay. It will feel in the same key.
Here's an important thing, though. It's not just that it feels okay. It's correct. So it's like, no, and we have had a backlash from musicians on this, right? And they get a bit annoyed. I'm going to turn my camera off because no one wants to look at me in my office. This is a Skoog, by the way. Squidgy thing. Let's turn that off. It's not that it makes everything okay. It's just like knowing your scales. So instead of having to know your scales, you you genuinely do, because it gives you the right notes to play. And so it's not, it's like, it's this weird thing, it's not faking it. You have the notes, like if you knew your scales as a jazz player, you would only play those notes, or you'd play, you know, notes that were linked to those, and if we gave you more. So it's not faking it, it's just taking away the stuff you don't need. You still make the choice about how loud, how soft, where it's placed, whether it's this one or that one. It's not just a scale or just a thing that's triggered off. We're giving you a palette and saying, right, here's what you need. Go for your life.
Perfect. Okay, and you were talking about how there's a lot of kind of free apps for touchscreen and stuff that do the same thing, so that allow a child who's just learning to develop their ear.
Yeah.
I'll take the screen back.
Say, you take the screen back. I'm just wondering whether I can get away with doing something. I'm not using. Yeah. Wait a minute. I'm using that. I'm not doing iMusic anymore, so I can maybe get away with this. Okay. I'm going to try and show you the screen to show you some of these apps. So one app that I think is so one thing that's really important in all of this, okay, in terms of this idea of babbling and musical play, is actually giving kids and giving people a context in which to work. You've been made the presenter. Do you want to share my screen? Not yet. Okay. And so you know that, I don't know, like, so I think, you know, Hector was talking about, you know, when he played recorder and hated it or whatever. And often, I mean, my own kids have done this. You know, going to school and they've been playing an instrument, it's a violin. I think for Coco it was the violin. And she loved it. She loved playing around with it. And it didn't matter that the sounds were scratchy. It didn't matter that it sounded, you know, to the trained ear, not so good. She was making sounds, and they were her sounds, and they rocked. And she was like, yeah, this is awesome. And then she took it into school, and people were funny about it, and she was like, well, I don't want to do that again. You know, it was embarrassing. And that's, you know, that's the kind of thing to avoid. So what I want to show you now, there's so many apps now, and was it David from Tobii? Yep. I was talking about these apps that, you know, facilitate stuff. I'm going to, so I go for my sharing screen. Can you share the screen with me? Does that, I need to show?
You're there. Yeah, we got you. Yeah.
You got me? Okay.
Yep.
Try this. Let's get rid of our music. Don't want to go. Pardon me, sorry. There we go. Just a bit of a sneeze there. God, I'm opening all sorts here. Get rid of that. So what I want to show you is an app called Bloom. And actually, Bloom you can use with Skoog, you can use with Ent, you could use with iMusic, because all you have to know is what key the stuff is in. And it works really beautifully. So hopefully now we're not. Yeah. No, it's fallen at the first hurdle. Wait a minute. But I've got a backup. There we go. Backup is good. Right, so I'm going to show you the screen. So this is an app. I'll show you the icon for the app and everything. I do need to move a recording here. I can share what I can see on my iPad with you. Apps now, and was it David from Tobii? Yep. I was talking about these apps that, you know, facilitate stuff. I'm going to so I go for my sharing screen. Can you share the screen with me? Does that I need to show?
You're there. Yeah, we got you.
Yeah. You got me? Okay.
Yep.
Try this. Let's get rid of our music. Don't want to go. Pardon me. Sorry. There we go. Just a bit of a sneeze there. God, I'm opening all sorts here. That. So what I want to show you is an app called Bloom. And actually, Bloom you can use with Skoog, you can use with Ent, you could use with iMusic, because all you have to know is what key the stuff is in. And it works really beautifully. So hopefully now we're not. Yeah. No, it's fallen at the first hurdle. Wait a minute. But I've got a backup. There we go. Backup is good. Right, so I'm going to show you the screen. So this is an app. I'll show you the icon for the app and everything. I do need to move a recording here. I can share what I can see on my iPad with you. Not me, because I'm looking rather, it's late and all those kind of things. There we go. So we should have now my screen. Get rid of that. So what I want to show you now quickly is this app called Bloom, right, which is created by Brian Eno. It's what's called a generative music app, okay, and it is just fantastic. It's so well put together, and one of these important things about it is the sounds are good quality. I would say Skoog is what we strive for. You know, for any kind of musical toy or plaything or instrument, it's got to sound good, and Bloom really sounds good. And what it does is it gives you a touchscreen interface like this, which can be the whole screen, and you just touch it anywhere. You get some visual feedback, and you get a note, but it's built in a way that it all fits, okay? And it repeats as well, so you can change the repeat time by the delay there, but it starts to create a kind of context, a backing track, something that's relevant to you, so that what you're then, the sounds you're making are not just hung out to dry, and it's not like you're just being put out and everyone's stopping, you're like, whoa, oh God, everyone's listening to me. You've got context to play it. And to play with, and that's, you know, normally in, you know, like babbling and stuff, it's our parents, our surroundings that provide that context, they provide that support, they'll sing with us, they'll play with us. But for just playing with sound, it's very difficult to get that. And apps like Bloom provide a really safe, beautiful environment for playing the sound, either by touch screen, or, you know, we could play Skoog along with this, we could play Thumb Jam along with this, we could play instruments in GarageBand along with this. But it will also, one of the really great things is if you press the listen button, it will play itself whilst you do other stuff. So you can play those other things and it'll start to be creative and it'll start to kind of create patterns for you to play with. And it'll be that kind of, you know, listening element beside you. So I think, you know, for $2.99, Bloom is a must have. If you've got, it's on Android as well. If you have a touch screen, and you're, you know, interested in playing with sound, and particularly with younger users who can either access a touch screen or, you know, all you have to do is be able to touch that screen, you'll be able to create stuff. It is.
So there are ways for us to mirror Android content on iGaze screens, on Windows screens.
Yeah, I mean,
we should be able to make that accessible to iGaze users. Somebody's asked a question quickly, Ben. Just because. Let's take time to answer some questions. What's that app called? That was Bloom. Yeah.
B-L-O-M.
Are there any online tutorials of how to use iMusic? iMusic for iOS?
There are some webinars. I can. Where's the best place to post them? If you look at the Skoog Music,
we can put them on Facebook afterwards.
Let's put some up on Facebook. There's some, and also
I'll send an email out to people after this.
And I'd be happy to do a fresh one as well.
Okay, great.
I've also shared a fantastic the Chrome Music Lab, if you've played with that before, which we have up on Tobii Dynavox.
I think we might get to that later as well, David. I've got a couple.
Okay, great.
Yeah, we're going to show that. Somebody's also asking, is it possible to achieve or teach rhythm to an iGaze user?
Yes.
What would be a good way to do that?
Well, it all depends. It depends on the level of the individual. I mean, if they're comfortable using iGaze, I mean, something like iMusic and, you know, giving someone that direct control, it depends. You would just use traditional. Once the individual has access to controlling sound or musical sound, then the teaching methods for teaching rhythm and things don't need to be that different from teaching anyone else.
One thing that will make a difference, though, are things like the dwell time that people have for the iGaze. So everything you've shown so far is just cursor over. So you just hover your cursor over to get the sound.
Yeah.
And that would require somebody, if they were trying to make that note at a certain time, to kind of move off it back on, move off it back on.
Yeah.
Now, there are, if I was thinking about how I was wanting to teach somebody rhythm, if it was somebody who was very good with iGaze, I would probably ask them to start playing with their dwell time. So that if there was a note to hit with an app that required you to keep pressing or clicking, that playing with your dwell time would be a good way to kind of teach you to kind of stay on something, but to sustain different amounts of time between your clicks. So
the dwell time itself is rhythmic. Dwell time is rhythmic. I mean, you decide between whether or not it clicks between a millisecond or 2 milliseconds or a second or however you have it. And if you keep somebody's gaze on one spot for a click, it will literally rhythmically click in that amount of time continuously.
Well, that's a very mechanical...
It is. It's like a metronome.
Yeah, which is not rhythm, but we can talk about that later. A metronome is mechanical time. Rhythm in any kind of form sense is always elastic and about human push and pull. So I would...
Sure.
I would personally... We can talk about that later. Okay, that's not necessary for this. Yeah. But I do think... I mean, I think it's more about... you could educate someone about rhythm through a continuous repeating dwell like that. So you could get the feel for it. But it's not actually enabling them to physically learn how to be rhythmic with the device. I think what we have to do is give AAC users, whether it's iMusic or whether it's Bloom or other things, that give you the response that is sensitive enough to allow you to be rhythmic, and allow them to make the mistakes that we would allow anyone else to make, and give them the time and space to learn to control it and to be creative with it to then actually master it and do that. No one is brilliant on the drums when they first play it. No one is brilliant on the bass when they first play it. No one, but we allow people to make mistakes and learn and play with that. I mean, there are things like beams, that are being brought now, which have those pre-programmed, quantized loops that will automatically fit in, and that's allowing you to take part. It's not teaching you how to be rhythmic. It's not giving you a sense of playing and controlling and actually being able to deliver that. It's allowing you to take part and play things, and that's great. But that idea of teaching rhythm, we have to give people the necessary tools to act in their environment in a way that allows them that level of control, and then actually help them with that and give them the time, the space, and the room to play that they need to develop those skills.
Yeah. So let's just quickly say something about Beams, because that is another piece of software that we've helped develop. Beams is essentially a mixed deck that comes by you breaking laser beams with your hands. And you can also use switches, so you can use up to 12 switches with it to play a loop that is set to context with a backing track. So it's probably just best if I just show a quick video of it. That's the easiest way. So what you're seeing here is Becky using her eye gaze, and you'll see we developed with them to just get thicker beams to hit. You'll hear kind of a gentle back track playing, but every time she breaks or sustains eye hold on one of these beams, it plays a particular instrument on loop in time.
It is pre-programmed, though. So.
Yeah, it's pre-programmed. It's no different to pressing a switch, and it's certainly, we shouldn't regard it as anything other than mixing.
So it is a bit more than a switch, I would say. It's so on the mixing side of it. So, I mean, artists now are releasing stems, what they call stems, which are loops essentially with their tracks to allow people to play them. So, she's not just turning the tracks on and off; she's bringing in a pattern. So it's somewhere between. It's somewhere between being able to play the instrument and be able to mix in sounds. It is more than just a switch, definitely.
Good. Okay, let's carry on. Just watch Becky for another minute or so. We're against the clock. Okay.
And it's fun.
It is. And it's well worth having a look at. Okay. Right. Other things to talk about, though, when we talk about music. Because we talked a little bit about what's culturally appropriate earlier, but what we also probably need to talk about is just the very fact that when we listen to songs, songs have words, and we're trying to get people's vocabulary to grow. That's a big hope for us all, for people who use AAC. I was actually dragged into a karaoke bar in at Isaac in Toronto
last week. I absolutely tried
you
to
say
avoid
dragged.
It.
I'm sure you were not.
I avoid it at all costs. But I was listening. I was watching the words to the songs, and I was thinking, "Wow, I never realised they said that." You know, it's that classic thing where you think they've been saying something else for 10 years, but actually they were saying something completely different. So, you know, it is a great thing to do to be able to give the kids the words to things that are culturally appropriate, and it's something that we should maybe look at. Now, Symbolate is a feature that's in BoardMaker Online. All of you can get BoardMaker Online free for 30 days, so you can play with this feature. Bob, are you still there?
I am.
Gone. Oh, he's here.
He's here? Bob, you here?
Yep, I'm here.
So, I think we looked... Well, actually, should we ask the audience what song they would like? Come on, audience, let's put... What song, what current song shall we... Should we create a communication board for? I'll just answer one of the other questions while we're asking. Somebody's asked, is the Beams free software? No, the Beams free software, it's about $100. I would have to double check. I think it was £80, the Beams software. Right, you've been challenged.
Our music demo software is free, though.
And your music demo software is free, great. So, right, so we've had Beyonce put a ring on it. Is the challenge, Bob.
Okay.
Isn't that Single Ladies, though? Isn't the tune Single Ladies?
Single Ladies, yeah. Yeah, good point. Thank you.
Not that I know anything about Beyonce tunes or anything. Single Ladies, Beyonce.
It's definitely Single Ladies.
Bob, you know that Ben likes Beyonce tracks. Good.
All right, here we go.
Who can like Beyonce? I mean, God damn it.
So,
it's awesome.
Let's hand it over to Bob.
Okay. So, can you see my screen?
Yeah. Can see you? Yeah.
All right. I'm just going to try this first. I'm just going to select the text here. Copy that. And go over to BoardMaker Online, where I've created a Symbolate button. And I'm going to click in here and paste. Oops.
Ah, I love it. I feel like asking Emily to sing now.
Oh, I mean, I'm quite impressed with that, though.
So, what Bob's done here is he's, you know, we've gone online, we've taken our core text. None of our other softwares do this. That's right, Bob, yeah? So, Communicator doesn't have this feature built in, the Symbolate feature. But, you know, if you think about culturally and in the moment, what is it I want to do? The music's on. Mum's at home. We want the kids to start learning their symbols, seeing their words even. Yeah? And just within seconds, we're able to cut and paste into a window and get symbols for the song we're listening to. Now, of course, I think we'd probably focus on the chorus for a lot of songs, I guess, because then we get that nice repetition. What happens if a symbol's missing?
If a symbol's missing and you want to add a symbol, you can double-click on the word, and you can do a search on a different want as a bed example.
You could say want, can you? I want or need or something.
Sure. We could do want, and I can do search. Oops, sorry. I want to do. This doesn't have a symbol, so yeah.
We'd have to do
change the word.
We actually have to go into my media and create a symbol.
What happens if we delete one at that point and just put one two?
We could do that.
It's so frustrating. I'm clicking on the screen trying to change Bob's screen, but it's not my screen.
There you go.
Yep, we can do that.
There you go.
Great.
Perfect.
Press print, and we have a fantastic thing to go alongside the tune that we're listening to. So we can now imagine kids using the Skoog music to play and intercept with the notes of different strengths, and all the time Mum could be showing them the lyrics to the song and giving them the kind of the cultural side of things at the same time. I love it. I love it.
I don't know about Emily, but the main thing is we've really got to, and it's not just kids in AAC, but we've got to give kids the room to play. And it doesn't matter whether old kids, young kids, whatever, we all, or adults, we need room to play with things, to be able to you know, fail or not get it right, and to you know, to have fun with it and to enjoy what we're doing, because then we'll learn. If we're having fun, we'll learn. If we're allowed to play, we'll learn. And when we'll learn new things, we'll have fun with them, and we'll just get better.
I just love, though, if you look at kind of core words in there, you know, we've got up. You know, that's a core word. And look, here's the symbol for it, and here's the word, and we're showing it in context, and we're listening to it. And every time the word up in the club, yeah, we just broke up, comes into the song, somebody can be pointing and reinforcing that symbol in real time as we hear it. And this has to have an impact on kids' learning and language. It must do. This is just all about us knowing the tools that are available to us to get things to happen nice and quickly.
I'm going to have to sign off, I'm afraid. I know I was late joining. I have children to put to bed and things.
Me too. Yeah. I'm missing Harry Potter right now. I get into trouble once every 2 weeks for my Harry Potter failures. Let's just finish off. I'm going to jump back to my screen. Bob, that was fantastic. Thank you. Let's just wrap up. So use the symbol 8 feature within BoardMaker or BoardMaker Online. There's my let it go. Let it go, yeah. There are some fantastic charities, especially in the UK. We're starting to see quite a lot happening with iGaze music because of this direct access. So you can see here a lad with a webcam, and then you can see here a guy with an iSeries. You know, these guys are now in an orchestra playing because they now have direct control. So
there's also Great Music Scotland as well that are doing
some nice stuff as well. Yeah. I'm sure we can organise future webinars and they show us their software.
In the Netherlands as well, there's the chap behind Magic Flute has created an iGaze and cam version as well.
I've been sent the Magic Flute software, so that's something we can maybe send somebody all these. We can send people these links after tonight's webinar, and just let you experiment with all of these different tools.
Yeah,
fantastic. We missed out the fact that it's collaborative. That's another thing that we need to start really kind of reinforcing. So
I thought we were collaborating.
But the fact that people can play on the same track, play on the same track at the same time with the different things. That's going to be a major part of it moving forward. Yeah. We've used up more than enough of your time this evening. I'm just going to wrap up. We've got some contact details. I'm Hector Minto, at Tobii Dynavox on Twitter, Ben at skoogmusic.com, and at skoogmusic on Twitter. Emily, what's your Twitter?
At Emily Webb SLT.
Great. I know that Emily's going to be running a lot of these clinic nights coming up, so keep your eyes on Emily Webb. We'll wrap up for this evening. Ben, David, Emily, Bob, everybody who's been listening. We've had about 30 people online most of the time. I'm sure there'll be questions afterwards on Facebook. We'll see you all again on a new topic in a couple of weeks.
Happy for anyone to get in touch with me, and I apologize profusely for the quality of Scotland's internet.
Bye-bye.
I'm emailing Nicola Sturgeon as we speak.
Good.
Good. All right. Take care, everyone. Good night.
All right. Cheers. Bye.
Bye.